So we're just going to go into Shiny Intro. We'll talk about a hello world. I'll talk a little bit about the structure of what Shiny is and how it works and some of the things that I've learned messing around with it for a while. And then I just sort of did a dump of a bunch of resources. So they're all in this PDF. This is all on my GitHub. You'll actually get a URL to it in a minute. So if you want to download this presentation and get those links out of there without having to write them down or anything, you can. Shiny is going through a significant evolution. When I started off writing in Shiny, you actually had to create a directory. You had to have two files in there. One had to be called server.r, one had to be called ui.r, and you had all these rules. It's gotten a lot easier to use than that, but still fundamentally, Shiny is really about two R programs. The first is the server in R. That's this pretty much the same R code you would write in a script. Just does the data crunching. The differences are that you need to put hooks in the server app to pass data back up to the user interface. There's a specific way you do that. And then the user interface program is really it's really a function call. And because of that, the way you program it is slightly different than the way you program R, and I'll go into what the details are. But it's all very straight, really pretty straightforward. And the basic deal is the UI, it's a graphical interface. You input data, the server sits in the background, crunches the data, spits back out the graphical information to the UI, and it displays it. So that's as simple as it goes. So here it is. So you can, if you want to copy this link, it's bit.ly. Just go to bit.ly slash pdx data underscore shiny. I'm just going to go out of here for a second and go into my browser so I can tell you where to go when you get there. Let's see if I click on that, what happens? Okay. Opens it right away. Sometimes you open Safari. Yeah, this will take you to my GitHub, repo on my GitHub. And what you want to do is go down and we're going to hit Hello World Shiny app right now. So you can either clone this whole directory or you can just grab Hello World. It's actually pretty short code. You can just literally just do that. You can copy it, hit RStudio, open up a new window on RStudio just to show how this works. And we'll paste it into a window on RStudio, just R script. And then you can just run it. And what should happen if you did that properly is you get a window opening up, and up in the upper left, a very nondescript thing is our Hello World. So we're actually communicating with our Shiny server. So what's going on here? Well, we've got Shiny server in the background running back here in this R script, not doing anything, just prints Hello World once and it's done. And then we've got our user interface. In this case, it opens up a browser in the a browser on your desktop, and it displays the output. Right, so that's what that does. So you open Hello World, and then let's talk a little bit about what this code is doing. So this is a picture of what the code is, so if you run it, it says. But the idea is you've got four lines here. The first is the Shiny library. So if you downloaded that from CRAN, it'll come up, otherwise it'll say you gotta download it and blah, blah, blah. The Shiny, inside there, there's the Shiny app call. So this is the new wrapper that you can put around the user interface and the server functions in your app. And it just makes it run as a single page. This is useful. I have a demo on that on the GitHub repository that uses this in a little more fleshed out way in an R Markdown document. So it's really nice for that. That's how I like to use these things. The user interface, here's the user interface, here's the server. The user interface is calling this thing called a fluid page. That is what tells, essentially instructs how the HTML is constructed and the hello world command. The server is just a simple function. It's got an input and output. Neither of those is defined, and there's no instructions in this function. So it's a super simple thing. If you ran that code, you would see this. That's what we saw when we ran it in our studio. And that's the hello world. So people seen that before, or is that just a question of how deep you want me to go on these things? But that's superficially that's our business. It's that simple to run Shiny. That's an idiotic thing, right? Why would you want to write a program to write hello world to a simple browser page? What you really want to do is actually have it do some user interactions, pull some information from the user, display some useful output, interact with the user in a way that helps inform them. And then you want your server function to actually hopefully do some computations to turn whatever data you're looking at into something meaningful in terms of analysis and output for the user. So where does that go in this? Well, it goes in two places. There are things called UI widgets, and we'll talk a little bit about those in a minute. They're UI widgets, and they're things like slider inputs, button inputs, text input, number input, go button, stop button, whatever. And those widgets get stacked up in here. There are also widgets for things like graphical output, text output, and things like that. So there's both input and output widgets, and you stack those up inside this page, or in this case, the fluid page function. And then the server function is here. And like I said, it's passing data back. You have to structure the program in a way so it knows how to pass the data back and forth to the user interface. And you do that by putting the code in between those curly brackets. Variables are passed using the dollar function. So you say input, if you have a variable named X, you would say and you're interacting with something in the user interface page to change X, and then you want to take action on that in the server, you'd pass it to the server as an input $X. And that's how you address that variable in the server app. So what are widgets? Here's a list. This is a page that has a list of all the widgets. This is a function reference for Shiny. It's on the RStudio webpage. And this is really the sort of the bread and butter if you're doing this development in Shiny. It's all these widgets are really the things that give flavor to the kind of output that you're generating. So I didn't list out the whole set here, but if you have your computer open, you want to browse to this page, you can see that there's a, in fact I can do that. There's a whole list. This is the page here. There's a bunch of UI layout things. So here's the fluid page, but you can put in header panels, help text, all kinds of things on your page to structure it the way you want it. There are UI input functions. So you can have action buttons, check boxes, data inputs, text inputs, action buttons, lots of different user input functionality, and then different kinds of output, HTML output, table output, you can have progress button if you want. And those are essentially the widgets that allow you to get going in Shiny. So I have a little actual demo. I can't remember what that is. I know what it is. Yeah, it's a more interesting program. And I was going to show you an actual demo. So I've got actual demo here.
Can you increase the font size?
Yeah, that might be a good idea. If I can get the right window, hold on. I and see, do we know how to do that?
Reload app?
You just command plus.
Oh yeah, command.
It's the easiest.
No, it's not doing it.
Or go to options, command comma.
There we go, yeah. All right, so here's the, thanks Guy. Here, this is a quicker demo of Shiny, and I just wanted to highlight a few of the things in here. Unfortunately, I started messing around a little bit, so it's got a few extra enhancements that aren't 100% necessary, but they're still sort of fun. So,
Listen, you've got the other one still running. You got to close it down before you run this one.
Thank you. So I just turned off. It was running a Shiny server in the background. And so this is another demo, and I'll just point out the same things. So here we have Shiny library. This is also called Shiny themes. That's a little utility library to help change the appearance of the browser that you open up. And then there are two functions here that are called, there's the user interface function, which has a bunch of stuff in here, and I'll show some slides to talk about what that code does in a minute. But this is again on the repo if you want to follow along. Just to point out a few things before we dive into it, you'll notice that the stored code has a few unusual things. It has commas. These commas can either go at the end of these lines or the beginnings. I put them at the beginnings for simplified debug. And then you have a user interface function defined within this fluid page that's got a bunch of stuff here. You've got the server, same thing. It defines a plot, basically, and has a function in it called output, dist hist is a variable that gets passed back to the user interface, and you use a render plot function to compute basically a histogram with a line on it. And then to get this whole thing rolling, once you've defined all that stuff, you use the Shiny app and you just reference it to the user interface and to the server functions and run it. And so let me run this app, and I'll just show you what it does. It's not a particularly exciting thing, but I've always liked, this is just sort of looking at the central limit theorem. So you're just taking a bunch of uniformly distributed numbers, computing their mean, and then taking a large population of that and looking at the shape of the bell curve that results. And so you can, in each sample, you can take, 10 up to several hundred points or several thousand points, and there you can see this thing narrows up because of the 1 over the square root of n and sigma, right? They have a large enough number of samples between 0 and 1, they eventually 10 to 0.5, and then you can take more or less large numbers of samples and improve the shape of the bell curve, and I'll do it the other way just so you can see this. So, but if you have a few samples, the mean tends to have a broader distribution. If you take a large number of those and look at them, again, the distribution becomes symmetrical, like a Gaussian. And if you do this, it narrows up. So that's sort of how that works. Well, this is all computed with just this code. It also does a... I built in a button to switch between the mean and the median. You can play with that on your own. Anyway, that's what that demo does. So let's talk about what that looks like. So these are the functions that are in that code. This is the top half, which has the user interface call and then the library demo and the libraries. I just want to point out a few things about this. So the user interface is here. It's defined by this fluid page function. I have a theme here. The theme just tells it, sets up the HTML with the fonts and spacing and things, colors and things like that. Then we start calling other widgets to build the page. First thing is this title panel. And this was just the title that was on top of the page. This is central limit, square root theorem, and the square root of n. This comma is here. The way these are traditionally written is theme equals shiny, comma, and then the title page here. The problem with that is that when you put the comma afterwards, you can never It's like, take, if you miss one or something like that, literally you can lose like hours trying to find it. Makes it much, bookkeeping much easier if you put the commas on the left-hand side. That's Winston's personal programming trick. And the other nice thing about that is that if you want to get rid of something, if you're having problems with a function, you want to just make sure you can recover again. It makes it much easier just to comment out the line. You can just comment that thing out, and the comma goes with it, so the next command automatically runs. And then that's where the comma's coming from. It's passed, this radio button thing is passing a variable called stat. The slider input is down here is passing an input called log points, which is the log 10 of the points in each sample. And another slider input saying the log of the samples, which is the log 10, specifies the log 10 of the number of samples that you're actually taking of the distribution. And then the other piece of it is you've gotten the input on this side with this side panel bar. On the main panel, what you want to do is have the output of the plot, and that's plotted by this dist-hist function, or by this dist-hist variable. The server part of the app is the same. Here's the server. Dist-hist is the thing that's actually displayed by the plot, and it's passed by this dollar function attached to output. The function here renders the plot, and it does some computations, takes a random sample, and computes the histogram, and then adds a bar in here at the mean or the median, depending on what this button is pushing. But that's sort of what this thing is doing. At a higher level, it's just straightforward R code, right? It's just straightforward R code.
So are the input and output names, those are important, right?
Yeah.
So you can't just change those.
Well,
or maybe you can change them, but you'd have to.
You mean here and here?
Yeah.
Yeah, there and there. The input and output, there are a few things that are inviolate about this. Maybe four, there's more than four, but there's at least four. You got to have something that's exactly called UI. You got to have something that's exactly called server. And you have to have this function that is input and output.
But it's this that has to be, that's fixed.
Yes.
This you can call
that. That
you
can change. Yeah. But you have to, this function has to be, has to have these two variable names, input and output. You attach all the information going back and forth to those variables as through the dollar sign. And then, as pointed out, you actually could redefine these things, but please, you'll drive yourself nuts. But you just use this function call, and it runs the code.
What is the type there that's coming from the interface? So why is that not prefaced with an input?
Which one?
You're switching on type, which is one of your radio buttons on the.
Oh, down here. This is just a defined function here, right? That's just a function that I built into the app. It's actually used. It's stat compute, and the radio button is passed down here, right? It is just taking inputs and outputs as a function, and then that function is passed down. This was sort of a neat little trick that I found. I mean, Scott's probably not familiar, I found it today, where you could actually use this switch thing. So you want to have a radio button that switches an actual function, not a variable. It's a nice way to do that. It's a nice little trick, right? So that's sort of a first grade. We can do the kindergarten hello world. This is sort of maybe first grade type of a shiny app. It's pretty typical of the kind of thing that you'll find. It's sort of the beginner demo. All right. So this, and then, yeah, again, so this shows what the output of that page looks like. Pretty close. That's basic Shiny. That's all I was going to sign up for tonight. I'm going to let the other guys do the hard stuff. But there's a lot of good information out there. So I tried to sort of catalog what I've uncovered as I've started doing this development. There's a great 2-hour introduction video. Just go to shinyrstudio.com and hit the tutorial. There are some videos from Shiny DevCon, it was about a year ago, but they're all still really good. And there's more video there than you can watch. And then, you know, beyond that, Shiny's really moving very quickly to supporting, live, production apps. You can do the cascading style sheet formatting, very simple. There's good tutorials on that. There's some tutorials out on training out on integrating JavaScript into Shiny apps. That's a lot more challenging, but boy, you can produce some pretty beautiful stuff. There are a couple of guys who are writing some training on that, and I think they're planning to write 5, and I think they've written 4. So this is really just in active development now. You can take these things and you can publish them on Shiny, it's called ShinyApps.io. So I don't know, did anybody here take the Johns Hopkins thing? And in the final project, you had to write a word predictor and publish it on ShinyApps.io. I still show that. I got mine still up there. I still show it to people. It's pretty cool. But it's pretty neat. I mean, you write this app, and then it's out there in the cloud, and you can just go to the web address that you assigned to it, and it's there, and you can show your mom or your friends or whatever, drinking beer to every other weird stuff I do. Our studio's having a conference in January. Is anybody from here going to that? Anybody going to that? Yeah, it's too much. But we should get some students here sponsoring or something. I think it'd be a cool thing. It looks like it's going to be a pretty good conference. And there's going to be a whole day tutorial on Shiny by the guy who essentially created it. So that's something. And I think after the conference, they'll publish videos, and it'll be worth looking for those. And there's tons of other resources galore. Some other things, here are some screenshots of web pages that I like to use. There's a gallery of Shiny apps. So if you're thinking about writing a Shiny app, you say, I want to put a map with, this on it. You can pretty much scroll through this thing and find something that's, 80% of the way there, and it'll save a lot of headaches. So I use this quite a bit. There's in your R Studio, there's actually a cheat sheet for Shiny web apps. So when you're actually doing this stuff, and you're like, you don't have to. You can just flip it open right in your R Studio. There's a lot of good articles on Shiny, and this is sort of a really good home page. You can see where all these extensions are starting to get added here, and so there's plenty of stuff to read there. Depending on the application that you want to write, there's material there that would support most anything you need. And then the other fun thing to read is the blog. There's always stuff going on. Sometimes it's details, but sometimes they're fairly major changes. And it's just good to come, sort of keep track of the development as you're using it. If you really want to go full crazy, you can get the Shiny Server Pro. I actually don't know what it costs, but
they have an open source version.
There's a free one, but if you want to, do serve up thousands of pages a day or something like that, they will support a production app. And I don't know whether the prices are competitive with like putting on Azure or Amazon, but something to look at. And it would make life easy if you were trying to get something done in a hurry. That's what I've got to talk about.
Any quick questions?
So I noticed you were using like only the plot function and that kind of thing. If you wanted to make more complicated visualizations, could you use ggplot?
Yeah. So on the repo that's here, I've got ggplot embedded. I'm currently working on a project where I'm trying to use ggviz. Anybody use that? That's because I want to have some interactivity in there. So you can use
So like any package.
You can use any package. I think, as far as I know, almost every R function should be compatible with the with it.
Anything else? Thanks so much.
Yeah.
Let's see. This is way way more kind of simple and preliminary in some ways than what Winston was going to do. I signed up to do this because I thought we really ought to be talking about Shiny, and I really don't know anything about Shiny, so the last few days I've learned a lot. Shiny, the name kind of always put me off. It just sounded frivolous, like, you know, who cares what? But I've convinced myself that it's an everyday tool. It's not so easy to use for the kinds of purposes that I originally envisioned it. And I put my code, such as it is, with links to resources up there on GitHub as well. So it seems to me, going back to the why R, well, R lets us touch the data, fiddle with it, interact. It's for that, it's designed for that from the ground up. The first kind of aha for me was a talk at this R meetup by a guy from Conway who was talking about convincing management in his company to basically believe him. He had to scrape all the data from this gnarly kind of source and replicate a phone bill for some 10,000 phones. And having a Shiny app that could replicate the different billing choices that the company had was the way to really justify the project. Second aha for me was seeing Hadley Wickham whip out a Shiny app where the residuals from 240 different linear models pointed directly to famine and war in Africa. And just having that pop up made me think, okay, this is not a frivolous tool. This is real bread and butter work tool. The other day, Roger Peng was talking about just how fast R is moving and how his students coming in at Hopkins start exploring data with Shiny, and even though he doesn't. I realized actually in that same podcast that dplyr is only 2 years old. I would never think of doing a project without dplyr. It's just like, duh. So, you know, that just shows us how we're tolerating a lot of real fast growth. And here's someone tweeting today about how yesterday there were 11,000 tweets on RStat. And, you know, I try and scan those tweets often at breakfast and at lunch, and kind of have had this illusion of kind of knowing what's going on, but clearly I don't. But still, the whole point, Winston's point here in his tweet, is that we use one tool that spans from data collection, data input, to communication. And Shiny plays a role. You know, I thought, okay, it's either community advantage where Shiny matters. But actually, you know, I've got a couple of examples of, you know, input and various things in here. So Shiny has a role to play all along the whole process. So basically, you know, I think Jessica's going to talk about what I thought was the original point of Shiny, which is a very sophisticated way of looking at complex data for the public. And I was hoping to end up with a little kind of exploratory data analysis that looked at re-expression and putting a histogram in R in in ggplot, and I totally failed, so I'll just talk what I've got here. Here's an example, some examples of where we've got those really sophisticated, shiny apps. Here's an example in data acquisition. It's basically an app where you just have a very wide data set and you go through and select the ones you want, and it produces some code that you can slap into your analytical process. This is a little called Data Pasta, which lets you grab, just cut and paste code from off the web and paste it into, it produces some little code for creating a tibble. So, you know, that's a real bread and butter thing, to create a tibble out of wherever you are.
Do you want to tell people what a tibble is?
A tibble is a kind of restricted data frame that has a few characteristics. It prints nice. It won't print 10,000 lines.
It's the thing you get when you use dplyr.
Yeah.
Short data frame.
So there are all kinds of gadgets out there, add-ins. Some of the ones that stand out are Color Picker, GG Theme Assist, Tidy Shiny. I've used that and found it to be not really that easy to do gather, but that's what it says it's trying to do. Naturally, there's an add-in list to list all the add-ins that exist, and copy that is a real handy thing if you're kind of running out of gas on R for some reason and you want to produce a CSV in your clipboard. There's a little app for it. So exploration should be really easy. You know, here's a drop-down menu in RStudio, and it's not so easy.
Hey, I'm Jessica Minier. I work at OHSU and I'm a statistician. So I'm just going to talk about Shiny app that I made. I started making this like 2013, right when Shiny was starting to be kind of well known. And it's evolved over the years. So I'm just going to give some motivation about why I made the app. Shiny Transcriptome Analysis Resource Tool.
Nice.
And yeah, love the acronyms. So if you don't know what transcriptome is, I'll explain that a little bit. So I'm a biostatistician, so I work a lot with people who do kind of genetic, genomic, proteomic, metabolomic, all those kind of omics research questions. And when they do this experiment and they give it to the sequencing lab, it goes through this pipeline, and they give it to a bioinformatician, and then the bioinformatician gives them a giant spreadsheet. And so if you're a computer scientist or a statistician, you like spreadsheets, but if you're a biologist or a clinician, this spreadsheet is really daunting. And it usually ends up having like 30,000 rows and so many columns, and they don't really enjoy working with this in Excel. You can filter, and you can make simple plots, but you can't really do a whole lot with it. Sophisticated unless you know how to use R. So this is kind of a very common problem in my life. Like, a lot of people are coming to me with these giant spreadsheets. And so it's rampant across OHSU. I think everyone has this issue. And so I was working with a collaborator who said, well, why can't we make this easier for people? Why isn't there a way to just upload your spreadsheet to something and have them be able to explore their own data? They're scientists. They want to explore their data, but they don't want to use it. So these data sets actually end up having, each row is meaningful to them because their scientists, we chose a gene or a protein or something that they're really interested in learning about. And then the columns tend to have statistical information that I am able to understand pretty easily, but when they see 30,000 rows of p-values, they don't really know what to do with that. So we wanted to make this easier on their lives, maybe a little easier on my life, because then they can just explore their data themselves. And when you have all this data, you want to make plots, and you want to make nice looking plots. This is a paper in Nature Genetics, and there's a nice heat map. And there's also bar plots and Venn diagrams, and but it's difficult for people to deal with the spreadsheet and make that. So they come to me, and they say, I want a heat map, and I say, okay, here's your heat map. And they say, no, I actually wanted a different set of data. I wanted only the top 20 genes. I only wanted the top 40 genes or whatever. And so I say, okay, here's your other heat maps. And now I have a folder full of 50 heat maps. And what are they going to do with that? And what am I going to do with all that data and all those files? So, and this is just to say that it's a really common problem. If you go to like the Bioinformatics BioStars website, and to the top, the second top most viewed question is, how do I make a heat map not? And it's not that hard for us, but for a biologist, it's a little more difficult. So instead of them having to Google it, Shiny can help them with that.
Wow.
And I just wanted to point out something that I thought was interesting is, originally my collaborator went to a computer scientist, and he was using Tableau. And if you've used Tableau, it's a really nice business analytic software platform, and it makes beautiful dashboards. You can do something similar to Shiny, but it costs a lot of money, and it's really hard to get people access to those dashboards. So this person, my collaborator, wanted other people off campus or just in, even on campus, to be able to look at their data. And so this was right around when Shiny was being developed, and I thought, well, if Tableau can do this, then Shiny probably could. And I should mention, Tableau now has some R integration, if you've ever used it, but back then it was really difficult to use. And so Shiny was just so much easier to make plots and to make a little bit more interactive with your data, dashboards. And so the first thing I did was made a dashboard with one data set, but now we have the data from all these different people, so we created an app that where you can upload your data and do the same. And that is where we came up with Start. And so there's, the code is on GitHub. You're welcome to use any of that code or just to explore it as you will. We have it hosted on this shinyapps.io platform, and it's actually free to host your Shiny app. So if you make one, you can make 100 and you can post them up there. I have a development version up and running too, just to have stuff to test. And we published some bioinformatics a couple months ago, just to say this is our app, this is what we do. So it's a really useful tool to kind of share your research question and just give it to the world. ShinyApps.io has more like paid versions where you can say, I want a password if you have really protected data, or I want to have really high volume, high RAM app, you can do that. But free version is really accessible. So I made a little quick video just to show you what it looks like. Basically, the way I have my app formatted is a lot of different tabs, and you can upload your data and do a bunch of different things with it, make different plots. There's like interactive plots. So if somebody asks if you can do your ggplot, and you can do ggbiz. The most of the interactive plots I've made are with Plotly. So if you've worked with any of those packages, you can do them on Shiny. I did find that ggbiz was a little bit slower to render for some reason. When we were publishing with bioinformatics, there was like a reviewer comment that said that these graphics are a little slow to load, and so I switched to Plotly, and it's a bit faster.
Is it like a factor two faster?
Or? Yeah, probably.
Really?
And it depends on your internet speed. I think it's mostly just loading the points for some reason. But Plotly is nice because it gives you these, you can kind of see it cut in my hover. There's like an option to save, and you can kind of explore, and with to. And I'll just show you the website soon. But just to get an idea is that I allow people to upload the data. So I made it so the data can be uploaded in CSV format, basically. And you upload it, or you can upload an R data file if you've already gone through the whole thing and downloaded it as an R data file. And there's like different plots, box plots, heat maps, PCA plots, a lot of different plots. The one thing that I think the main thing that was people were asking for with this type of data is they have genes in mind that they wanted to look at the expression profiles. So this Shiny app allows you to say, okay, this special gene, is it higher expressed in one sample versus another? And you can just search for the gene and get the data out and get a plot out.
Jessica, what do you mean by log-fold changes?
So when you do a genomic experiment, usually you have two groups or multiple groups. So let's say you have two groups. They're most interested in the fold change for different genes at between those two groups.
The fold change.
So let's say you have treated and untreated, and you have gene X. And if you have like a baseline level in your control group of 100 expression, and say two fold change, then it would have 200 folds in the treatment group. And so when you're it depends what kind of experiment you're doing, but if you're doing a genomic experiment with like RNA-seq or microarray data, usually people do this on the log scale, just because that ends up being more normally distributed. So for testing purposes, it's a lot easier to deal with. So that's a common, so there's usually a common way of saying this is different between two groups. So you have p-values, but then you also have like the size of your difference. Mm-hmm. It's usually expressed in that. So that will get, you'll have one of those. So you'll have one of those for each of your rows in your data. So in other words, for your 30,000 genes, you'll have 30,000 p-values, 30,000 the other thing I was mentioning, heat maps are really big with this type of data. So you can search and filter your data and make a heat map for any kind of combination of data that we have based on significance of your genes or fold changes. And Plotly and ggplotly are really useful. And so in terms of what packages we can use with Shiny, when I first started with shinyapps.io, they were only allowing our current packages, but now they have BioConductor, and you can even do GitHub packages. So just as long as it can load in our workspace, it can load on shinyapps. So it can really anything now. And the other thing I found useful is that when you upload data to our app, you have to go through some steps. You have to say, like, this is the column that has the p-values, the column that has the fold change, but what I did was make it so that people could save their data in our data file, download it. Maybe they don't really know what that means, but as long as they save that and then upload it later, it's just a lot quicker. So you can do kind of download files, you can download data tables, you can download whatever you want, and then upload it later and just explore some more if you wanted to do that. Still adding new features constantly. So I just wanted to mention that, maybe I should just show you what the app looks like again. So it's on shinyapps.io, and you can see there's a lot of different tabs here that have different interfaces. I think now, so when I started making this, tabs was kind of the default way to do things. Now there's something called Shiny Dashboards, which I think is a bit more sophisticated and looks nicer based on the newer apps that I've seen. But this kind of does the same thing.
Yeah, you did a nice job with this.
This looks
really, really great.
Yeah, a lot of tweaking, but it's fun to make. So everything's kind of divided up into each tab. And I just wanted to mention that if you go into this code, if once it started getting really unwieldy, I just started dividing up the code into different files. So like I have this UI tab is only for the input data tab, this one's only for the filter data, and you can actually divide up your code and have it source through all these different files. So if you want to separate about your data, if you're looking really into the organization, that's one good thing to start with. And you just have to do it this way. And back when I started writing this code, UI.R and server.R were separated, so I just kept it that way for posterity.
What does dollar value do there?
I think this just, because it's sourcing a UI tab, it's like a different kind of R code, and I'm not entirely sure, but you have to put the dollar value in order for it to know that that code goes straight into the UI code. So I don't know. I wish I knew more about that.
We'll do what you say.
Yeah. It's what works.
That's where a lot of stuff works.
Okay.
For some reason, so I did that for the UI tab and then the server tab. You don't have to do that. It's just because I think the server tabs are really just R code, per se. And so it's just sourcing R code and it knows. But the UI is like building the different tabs and it knows that it needs to put the value. I don't know. I haven't explored that. So one thing I don't know that was really that mentioned in the previous talk so much is this idea of reactivity. And it's really important and shiny. And especially if you have something that builds on other actions that are going on in the other tabs. And so you can imagine in this app, you have to upload data. And it needs to know that the data was uploaded to do other stuff. And so this is like a reactive event. And my app has a ton of reactivity things going on, but I think the most important one is this analyze data reactive function that I made. So this is a function for a shiny code, and event reactive is the function type. And what really is happening is it's depending on this input event. So upload data is the name of something that's happening, and that is actually a button where I say, I put up this data, now submit it. Now everything else needs to happen. And because each tab, so like, which one is this? For example, the heat map tab has the group names in the filters, but when you upload data, it takes the group names from the CSV file. So that needs to change anytime someone uploads a new data set. So what the reactivity says is if this happens, if someone presses the submit button or even there's other ways to do it where if something else changes, then do all the other stuff. And this is saying when that happens, update all of these different, this is the analyze data reactive function. But this is what I wanted to say. If the analyze data reactive function happens, then update the radio buttons, update the checkbox group input, update the selectize input. Everything updates. I have this all over my code, and it gets really confusing sometimes to know. It's really hard to debug, I should say. You have something reactive and something else. But there are some really nice, if you watch a lot of the shiny videos on our studio, they help you with this, to help you with debugging when you have a lot of reactivity in your code, because you can kind of tell what's happening at each step and what is causing the issue. So something to think about when you're writing shiny code is this idea of reactivity and what event reactive means, and then there's reactive functions, and this is an observe function. And so observe means look inside this code. If anything changes, then run the code. And so what really is probably going to happen is someone ran the data analyze function, and that changed, and so we'll change everything else. So there's a lot of different things that can trigger, I guess, this function. But that's like the whole basis of Shiny is things depend on each other, and they call it reactivity, where it's reactive to one event versus another. And there's a lot more code on GitHub. Feel free to use whatever you want. It's all there for you. So we're working on a lot of different extensions. If anyone wants a fun project to work on, we're looking for help. I wrote all the code, so
whatever help I can get. And that's it. Can you give me just a very, very high level ballpark guess of people hours to get
to write all? not, so I'm a statistician, it's not like my full-time job. So I would say probably like 100 hours it would take to get it up and running, you know, to get it. So this is a really, I should say the most basic version that we started with. I wish I still had that on here. So it's really basic. And it was basically one data set. So this whole uploading of data business was really complicated to make sure it all worked. I think that was probably the hardest part. I think the original app probably like 30 hours or something. It was a lot less. Just if you have like a really fixed idea in your head of what you want to do, it's a lot easier. Whereas this, the main idea was that we wanted to make it easier for a biologist who just had never done data analysis to upload data. And it had to be in like the Sprite format and everything had to work properly. And the debugging part, I think, is probably what took most of the time. For sure. Yeah. A lot of time. Yeah.
So are you using the same servers in OHSU in the terms of, because I know what you're doing there, and the data size of probably approaches 2 gigabytes, so I'm assuming where those are.
Well, I think so. If I remember right, this, I don't remember what.
Could you repeat the question? I was completely distracted.
Crazy talking. In other words, you got to have a lot of horsepower to run this kind of data set with the code behind it. And what are you using to do this? It's this kind of data size.
So can you write it on, run it on your desktop?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, but not for the data
set. For the server. So for a while, we were running it on the Shiny Apps.io free version, which does not have very high instance size. It's pretty limited. And that was working okay until other people started using it a lot.
Yeah.
So we presented it, and then other people were using it, and we had different people at the same time. And then we upgraded to the next. Like maybe this standard version or whatever it is. It doesn't take a whole lot of RAM or memory or whatever for one instance, but I think it's just having people hours takes a long time. Actually, I should say, if you try to run this heat map with more than, like, I even put a warning, more than 5,000 genes, that is when it gets above this lower Shiny app. So it's certain interactive, I want to say the interactive heat map is probably more, but it's more like the R calculation. So if you're doing like an R calculation that's really intensive, that is what takes a lot of the time. Yeah. And also right now the bioinformatics group at OHSU has it running on like a Shiny server. I don't know if it's pro or free or not, but they have it running on their own computers and they're giving it to the like clients. I don't know what level they have, but it's working okay for them.
I'm trying to run this in Microsoft Cloud or something like that. They moved all that Hadoop stuff to the back end now.
Or an Amazon.
Yeah. Just some cloud service, because I think that's the way we're all going anyway, right? We're all going to be running this.
Right.
Yeah. WordPress.
But I really appreciate that the Shiny apps people have a
real price. Yeah, it's expensive.
There are a few more questions.
Sorry, the web server is like the Shiny server. Is it Apache? Is it IIS Express? Is it Node?
I don't know.
Well, you could probably recycle the page and look at the headers on that page. I don't know. They might be hiding the server, though. We'll see. It says server open resty. No, I've never heard of it.
Depends. Well, it depends like who knows about this, right? So heat maps or like box plots. But I didn't mention that this app also does some basic analysis. And that part, I think just kind of interacting with people and asking what they want is the part that takes a long time. And so when they are able to upload the data and then explore it a bit and refine their questions, I think that saves me a lot of time just because they can look at, they can query the data however they want. So I don't know if I could give an example of how much hours, but it's nice, I think people appreciate it. You know, they're biologists, they're used to measuring stuff themselves, and when they get this giant data set, they don't really know what it looks like, but just the numbers. And when they're able to see it in plots, I think it's meaningful.
I had a question. Have you considered, you know, some Shiny apps will show the code that creates the, have you considered that, or does it already do that?
So you can run it in the, there's an option in Shiny, a dashboard version or something version where it runs the code and it shows you what code is running at the same time. I've done that for myself for debugging purposes, but yeah, that would be nice to be able to have.
I don't know. Maybe your users don't want to run it themselves.
But it may be a separate version that has that. Yeah. It helps me.
App is doing. So here's an example of sort of a random process. And what my anomaly detection app, I call it CAD, is doing is it searches for subsequences of a time series that has a subtle shift in the mean from the rest or the surrounding parts of the time series. And I use sliding window technique, and so it basically this comes in handy later on when I will try to speed it up and use MapReduce. But for now, let me just show you more pictures that might be. So this is the picture from the first page, and an example of a process. So the reason I came up with anomaly detection algorithm was because I was an intern at measurement labs. They do a lot of network diagnostic tests, and those test variables really look like a random process. And normally what happens is that if there's a internet brownout or sort of slowdown of the internet of any sort, shape, or form, it shows up like these anomalous red dots with respect to the rest of the service. So my app is a good way for them, well, it will be once it kind of is faster, to search through basically large data sets and look for anomalous events that might have happened in the past. So that was the motivation for me to come up with this anomaly detection. So note that this one really is meant for random processes. So if you are looking at just some sort of more something that has a period to it, or some, you know, it's really obviously some functions graph, this will give you nonsensical results possibly. So if you graph a straight line, or the results are not going to give you anything meaningful. Well, it would still do what it was supposed to do. Okay, so if you're interested, I don't really want to get into the CAD part, but if you're interested in more about the anomaly detection app, the paper, here's a link to the paper, and actually to the code for just the algorithm itself without the web app. And I think we're going to post these somewhere, so if you don't have to copy them now, you should be able to find them, these links somewhere. So, okay. Excuse me. So, also, I have more code. Actually, this one, I actually have a web app up and running on my blog. And I'm just showing you that this is an earlier version than the one I would show you, but I am using the Shiny app.io sort of cloud.
Can you increase the size?
Yes, I'm sorry. I wasn't gonna linger too much on this. I was just, I gave you the link in my presentation so you can look at it. You can actually run it and this is the app that I'll be focusing on, and mostly I will just tell you about my learning process and what kind of difficulties I had to come up with. It had a lot to do with reactivity and figuring out how to make it so that when users, how to interact with the users and make the app respond appropriately. So I'm not gonna run the app actually, but let me go back to the presentation. And here is sort of a video demonstrating quickly what how to use. So you have an option of either uploading your own data set or using an example data set. And there's a lot of parameters that you get to change. And here's an actual data set. What I'm showing right here is the actual table or CSV file that you uploaded. This one only had one column. And then as you run the detection, the plot of the time series will show up, and then below it the anomalies and the list of the anomalies. And now I'm showing you what it looks like when you can upload a file. So you get to choose if there are multiple columns, you can choose whichever column you're interested in. Then the units, you can change the units. The answers are sometimes more meaningful in different unit. So this was synthetic data. I just came up with some random stuff. And I actually shifted the mean and just ran an anomaly detection app on it. Some of the lower parameters, the ones that you actually end up adjusting would sort of increase the sensitivity of the algorithm and in terms of what I'm looking for. So I know I rushed through this. I really just wanted to give you an idea what the app sort of does. You can, if you wish, you can go to my blog and try to play with it. I warn you though, you might have seen that there was a cutout and there was a break between me running the app and then the results. And depending on how big of a table you upload, you might not even get your web app might actually just give up on you. So the calculations take quite a bit of time. By that I mean maybe a minute or two, depends on how big your data set is. And so for now, this is, it's fun for me, it's not for anybody else. I was thinking of some options, like maybe people can upload their results, set up the parameters, and then I can just mail them the results, like send the app and email them the result. Or what I'm really hoping to do is just use some MapReduce and speed up the whole thing. But for now, it's working, but it's not fun to work with. Okay, so some of my challenges, the first one was, oh no, how do I make them upload files? As I said, this is, I've not done any web development. I've worked with some CSS and HTML stuff, but nothing more than that. Another part was, because there are so many options depending on what's going on, I wanted the widgets to appear and disappear depending on what the user does. I didn't want to have a big crowded screen. I did notice the tabs option, but I didn't want to go into it too much. Another interesting thing was, how do I make it so that there's a message on the screen while my app is actually running the anomaly detection algorithm in the background. So I thought I'll share those three problems and my solutions to them with you. Okay, so here, these are my resources. So definitely one of the ways I ended up going about things is to look at the gallery that Winston has mentioned. And it was, I just looked for things that look similar, and I was able to look at the code also with it. So that was cool. The whole Shiny reference manual is very nice and usable, so I've used that a lot. And then Stack Overflow and Google when all else failed. Okay. So how do I get users to upload a file? The form is just file input ID display label. And actually here, this is what it looks like. So I just gave you the generic code for it. I will also give you at the end a link to my GitHub repo so you can actually see.
Does file input give you the progress bar too?
Sorry?
Does file input give you the progress bar for upload? Yeah. Okay. Cool.
I guess. I didn't do anything too fancy. So the next one was, how do I make the widgets appear and disappear based on the user input? And this had to do with reactivity. And again, I had to modify the UI.r file. And there's a command called conditional panel, and I used it, actually nested it several times occasionally to have the results that I wanted. Interestingly enough, I've not used JavaScript, so it was interesting to end up having to use JavaScript in some of the parts here. The condition is itself a JavaScript expression. So, for example, one of the things I wanted to do was, when people select, say it says, choose the unit of time, they get to choose either just some generic, you know, the indices of the time series, or have it be representing days. And if I wanted it so that when the user clicks on days, there would be a way for them to actually enter the date, but I didn't want it to, the date part, I didn't want it to crowd the interface, only if they end up choosing it. So I use conditional panels in the UI interface to sort of have part of, so just this widget up here. Okay, and another example was, okay, I wanted the rest of the interface appear once people clicked on the button process upload. So I didn't want the whole interface to be there. I didn't want people clicking all over the place ahead of time before anything was uploaded. So my solution was to not have any buttons to click on until that time. And again, the conditional panel now, what was kind of nice to me is that the button's name within the UI .r code is enter upload. So this part here, input.enter underscore upload, is actually just the bucket itself, and it will be either two or files depending on whether it's pushed or not. So that was kind of nice to discover. And this is, you've seen this, but once you click process upload, then the rest of the things appear. And then, now this one I ended up having, I think, using some Google in order to figure out how to make this run. So while the app is running in the background, I wanted a message to come up that show, okay, hold on, it's gonna take a while, don't run away. And this is more heavily into just more in depth, shiny. I needed to use tags and IDs. And so this is what I'm referring to. So find the anomalies, you click on it, and then it says this might take a while this is running. And that was that part. So again, my code for the app can be found at this link. And it's just so shiny, all of it.
Questions?
It was just, you know, larger table, maybe in terms of rows, maybe up to like, if it's over 30,000 rows, then it starts to be kind of slow, like a minute or two, which is long if it's a web app.
when you run it on your blog, where is it running?
It's hosted on that shiny app.io, and it's free because for now. I think once if there's a lot of users, then things might actually go crazy. But
you can
pay, but. I haven't advertised it too much because I wanted to make it run faster before I actually make it tell all the people at Measurement Lab that they should run it and use it.
What do you think is the sticking point? Is you're probably is the algorithm kind of slow? Like, could it be slow?
Yes, because I'm using a sliding window. And I'm moving it over by one data point usually. Just, I'm sure I haven't tried to optimize it yet. Since I had like 3 months to come up with the algorithm and code it, and so this is sort of a work in progress at this point.
There's a cool tool that the Art Studio people make that uses Shiny. That's a profiler. Have you used the profiler?
No.
Does anybody know the name of the package? With Profis? Yeah, Profis.
Oh.
So you could run it on your code, just not the whole app, but just the algorithm part, and figure out what are the slow parts. And then,
oh, okay.
And it would point to like specific lines of code.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I will do that.
Any other questions?
Yeah, so if, and I don't know if this is yours, but if I want to run it, say, within an organization, I want to run it on a server inside the firewall. Employees use it. Do I need to do the paid version, or can I do it with the free version?
You would have to run it inside the firewall, right? Firewall server.
Yeah, but with that free machine,
you have the machine, then you take the free code and put it on there.
The pro version is when you want to have a password for a specific Shiny page.
It is.
That's one of its features.
Like when you have a paying customer.
Right.
I really thought it also had to do with how much memory you end up using. And
the Pro version has load balancing when you have multiple users running simultaneously and other kinds of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it makes sense for it to be.
Yeah.
So I guess maybe what you might be asking, another way of asking, the actual server that runs Shiny, the code that is the Shiny server, is free if you want to do your own self-hosting.
Yeah.
But if you want to externalize the hosting, let someone else deal with that, that's what you're paying for.
No, you're paying for a different version of the server code that you run on your server. There's two versions of the software.
So for example, let's say you wrote this, Kingo wanted to, her app was so valuable she wanted to sell the rights to use it. So somebody, she could, in Pro version, she could send somebody a password and they could use her app.
Yeah, I think there's a bunch of companies that use Shiny, so just a matter of getting in touch with them and seeing what they do. I don't know much about it.
I honestly haven't done much research. I was just so glad it worked.
Yeah.
And then I could put it up and it worked. I didn't look into any other details, not yet.
Cool. Are there any other Shiny questions for the speakers or anything in general? Cool. Well,